So, hi, this is Stu, and I'm here in the beautiful garden settings this time of Purple Valley, and it's quite sort of appropriate because I'm here with Petri Raisanen, which is great, and we all know him obviously as a fantastic yoga teacher, but definitely also with a very sort of therapeutic touch to it, more emphasized than we see in some other teachers. So I thought this was quite a nice appropriate setting in the nice sort of tranquil gardens, and we're going to try and also give you some easy lead in to how maybe you can try and use some of these ideas for yourself as well. And so welcome, Petri, and great to see you again after since last year. And great, so I wanted to start mostly by asking you, about your, where's your own practice at the moment in its evolution? Are you still aiming to change what you can do, or how do you go about thinking about your own practice?
I think I start to be more focused for the teaching than making so much physical progress in my own practice.
Yeah.
I think it's the progress is more in a mental side. We all get older and
unfortunately.
And I have a family again. It's the baby's 2 years old.
Yes.
So it's been quite challenging to travel around, teach, and try to practice somewhere there before, after the teaching.
So. But what's quite nice is you all go as a family most of the time, don't you, around the
place?
Sure,
yeah.
So that's quite cool too.
Yeah, it's amazing to have this. And also Bamboo has started to teach and also give workshops. So it's really nice. So.
And some of her videos as well, being that we've done here, have been like super popular. Like I think there's over 120,000 hits on the beginner's sequence and that. And so it's like she also has a really nice, soft, gentle energy in the way that she approaches.
Yeah, she really has the nice touch and nice feminine touch.
Yeah,
Like a soft and gentle.
So now you're saying, okay. I mean, obviously the asana practice and the meditation pranayama are all things that you're going to keep going and working on yourself. But when you're saying about developing your skills as a teacher, what do you think would make you a better teacher? This is like a job interview, isn't it?
Well, a little bit more about my practice. I've been mostly doing second series.
Yeah.
Not so much primary.
Okay. And before you've also gone to what?
Yeah,
end
sure.
of third
like,
or
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah, end of third.
But yeah. Was that
now it's been mostly second series and it just feels amazing to to do the back bends and I started to stay longer in the poses.
Yes. So which
so I do all the Salabhasana, Bekasana, Parasana, all with 10-15 breaths.
10-15 breaths, nice.
And try to find the relaxation and a comfortable pose.
Yeah.
And it just feels good. It just feels amazing. Instead of like breathing 5 times and push hard and try to get as high as possible.
Yeah.
You like take a little bit easier, breathe more. And well, in the beginning it feels hard to stay longer.
Mm.
But then when you get to use it, it's beautiful.
And was that a conscious decision? Did you decide one day, okay, I think I'm now going to hold them all for 10? Or did it happen naturally as an evolution that you suddenly found yourself holding things?
What happened that my body somehow became a little bit slow.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if it's age or what it is. It's just a little bit slow. When I do forward bend, it takes a little time to get to the back bend.
Yeah.
Even in the... when you do the vinyasa, like upward dog, downward dog, even there, doing like, and then going to the downward dog, I have to
ease into it.
Yeah.
Well, so, you're 97 so this, or something there, aren't you?
Yeah, just 48. But, I don't know, it just became a little bit slow. I don't know why it happened. Maybe some tension in a sacrum area or something. But this, breathing long and relaxing and try to find a comfortable pose, it really helps. And
yeah.
And because if you do quick movements and you feel the tension. It in the end, the tension will move to the like pain. And
yeah. And so how do you set about it when it is, say, I mean, I'm not sure how challenging Capitasana is for you, but for many people, it's like super challenging, super intense. So the breath shortens and the thought of staying there for extra breaths is really... So how do you mentally deal with those sorts of ideas that are coming in, up in your head, if that's what you experience?
Yeah.
Or when you did, perhaps?
Well, I just take it easy. I'm not trying to catch my heels.
Yeah.
I just go as far as it feels like, feels good.
Which is nice, and just stay in that
zone. Which is like... I'm comfortable if I go in the middle of the feet, you know, and just stay there and breathe and come up and still feel comfortable.
Yeah, rather than come up and feel broken.
You know, what I see all the time is that people has lots of fear, even trauma.
Yeah.
From Kapotasana. It's not very smart, you know. If you practice yoga, you should kind of open body and mind, and then you get traumas and so much fear. That, you know, some people cry.
Yes, when they come out.
When they, even before Kapotasana, because it's so
building
it's
up
so
in
scary. You know how much there is pain, how much you have to push, and you come up and and it doesn't feel like it gets better.
Yeah,
the trauma is there, and only way to kind of get it out from the system is to really change something
and relax into it.
I don't know. There is different ways to teach. Some people like to push. Some people like to take it more gentle. I think what happened to me is like from the 90s when we pushed very hard.
Yes.
It really became very, very gentle.
And so, but that is quite good because it gave you an insight into what many people are experiencing, and maybe these other roots grew out of that.
Sure. You know, when you give gentle adjustment, you feel the body much, much more.
Yeah.
I mostly use my hands, so the hands are very sensitive.
Yeah.
If you use your elbow or knee, you know,
there's
no nerves.
Yeah.
But here you feel everything, and you feel the muscles, you feel where is the tension. Like you can always do some nice things.
Yeah. And one of the students here that was seeing me was also, we were talking about this, the adjustments and things, and they said, it's not that necessarily the adjustment is always very gentle as far as the depth of the posture, shall we say, but they felt that your hands on them were feeling everything, like you said, and very aware, and it was the right amount of depth for them, rather than, we're going to take you to the floor, we're going to take you, whatever. Yeah. So that is also being picked up by the students, of course. Mm. And that also helps them relax, doesn't it? And be able to breathe and know they're safe with what you're adjusting.
Yeah, so I think some teachers think about what is the kind of the first state of the pose.
Yeah.
Like, okay, now the head has to be there and the body has to be. I don't think like this. I just think like, okay, this body, and this mind and this person, and then we just go as far as it goes with that person.
Yeah.
Like prasarita parottanasana si, I don't think that the hands has to touch the floor.
No.
I just think like how far it goes
and
the person still feels comfortable.
For that individual,
yeah. Yeah. And otherwise, next day they do it again, so it doesn't have to be one day and it has to
touch the floor straight away. Yeah, exactly.
But this way, it really creates nice relationship between the student and teacher, and that they trust the teacher and they're ready to open. And and it's good for both.
And maybe that even instills in the student that actually it's okay to be where you are, rather than when you're always taken so much deeper, that almost reinforces the idea, well, this is where I should be, and anything less than that, I'm not good enough, or I'm not going in there.
Well, if you think, we are not talking so much in a yoga class. So we try to support the meditation in the class and the peace and calmness. And if we are not talking and we give adjustment, so the adjustment is actually what is showing the whole yoga system for the student.
Yeah.
So with the adjustment, you show the alignment. and you saw the pose, but also everything else.
Yeah.
So basically the adjustments would show the also the yoga philosophy.
Yes, yes.
So that experience in that pose, in that moment, you get like, oh, this is yoga.
Yeah, yeah.
And it can happen through the adjustment. The gentleness, the caring, all the like, the touch, everything is there.
Yeah, it sort of instills that idea that they should be also compassionate to themselves, you know, because some people do beat themselves up a little bit, don't they, on the mat. And yeah. And so, yeah.
And we also, we try to give quite lots of responsibility for the student.
Yes.
It's not like we tell everything what to do and like run around like saying like this is wrong and this is right.
Yeah.
But we look, okay, this person is doing a little bit wrong, but...
You let them explore.
Let them explore maybe a few days and then slowly go there and like, okay, let's do it this way.
Adjust a little bit, yeah.
So the person can also do their own way. The person can also be wrong in a pose. It doesn't have to be like... so strict and everything has to be exactly right.
Exactly. And so when you're come across students that are very ego driven, very strong in all the postures, how do you sort of coax them out of that? Because of course if it's a straight on confrontation, which I imagine is not your style anyway, then those sort of people just dig their heels in and they're not going to change. So they need to sort of be shown, well, that there's a different way.
Yeah, there is. Every time there is a workshop, there is people come from different places,
yeah,
and different teachers and different styles. And many times they do something else. So if it's a longer workshop or retreat, yeah, I let them do wrong, like different style.
Yeah.
And if they ask, like, okay, what is other people do? And I show them. If they don't ask, sometimes I'm not even showing.
Okay, you just let them.
I just let them to do their thing. They came to Ashtanga retreat to practice with this teacher, but if they're not interested about Ashtanga yoga,
yeah,
and what I'm saying, they can do what they want.
They let them do what they want.
It's like, and it never happened actually.
No.
It just happened for a few days that they do something, and then they're like, "I want to learn this."
Yeah.
So you break the ego that way, that it comes from them.
Rather,
it doesn't come like you like, you know, if you don't do this, you're out.
Yeah, yeah.
Or like, I'm the teacher here.
Yes.
That kind of attitude.
Yeah.
I'm like, it's up to you. If you want to practice Ashtanga, you practice. And
yeah,
if you don't, then you can come here. It's the main thing is that people come to the shala and practice.
Yeah. And then there's a potential
I don't care
change,
so much if it's
it?
Like strictly Ashtanga yoga. Is it like... Yeah. Partly Sivananda or something. But it never happened. Every time they wanted to learn.
Yeah.
And you see the person comes with the ego, you're like, I don't want to fight with this person.
No. So but some like, of that comes from obviously from you as well, as being seen and absorbed as very open and available and not confrontational yourself. So therefore the person, I think, maybe feels secure in the fact they can explore these options with you.
Yeah, they feel like, okay, this is safe.
Yeah.
I can safely let it go.
Yeah.
And do something else.
Yeah. And in the, again, the welcome meeting this time, I remember you saying that, you know, very much emphasis on the therapy and not so much on the asana. Can you, obviously we also view the asana themselves as potentially therapeutic, which of course they are, but only done in a sort of way that helps the body. Can you expand on that a little bit for us? What was in your mind when you said that?
Yeah, like I said, the main thing is that people come to the shala and practice.
Yeah.
That's yoga. So the main thing is not that like people do second or third series and make do so many asanas. The important is that the person experience yoga, they feel comfortable, they want to continue after the workshop. They feel like this was a great experience, I really want to do yoga, I want to read yoga philosophy, I want to go maybe to the temple, I really love it.
Energized.
Yeah, energized and like feel like, okay, this was for me. I got what I wanted. And so sometimes if it's so much like about the asana and the progress and the advanced poses, and it's all about like being advanced. So some people doesn't, well, if you're not, if you're old, if you're stiff, if you like, if you injured, you might feel quite uncomfortable, like if the main goal is just be so advanced and do some handstands and super jump through some like a slow motion jump through.
Yeah,
that's like the goal. So people are like, this is not for me. Yeah. I want to do easy hatha yoga somewhere else.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think Ashtanga can really give something for everyone if you just, you know, work with that person, with that body and with that age and mind. And And also with their problems, whatever is the problem. It's, if it's just the stiffness, that's quite easy.
Yes.
But some people has mental issues, and some people has injuries. And yeah, it's and people really feel like, okay, if you take care of that, you know, you have an injury, I try to fix it.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to fix it, kind of. It's yoga, it's just fixing. I am just like supporting that process.
Yeah.
And the person really feels like it was for me. It was personal, you know, connection. And, yes. And they really want to help.
Yeah. And so how would you go about that? So somebody says to you, oh, I've got pain in my hip when I do a particular posture.
Hmm.
What is the processes that go through your mind or that relationship with the student that allows you to help them in the right direction?
Yeah. So maybe we discuss.
Yeah.
And they tell what happened, why they have problem. Maybe they doesn't know where it is. So we start, usually we start in Adho Mukha Svanasana, downward dog.
Right.
That's where we start the process. So I put one hand to the sacrum, fingers on the both sides, and then checking like what is
how the balance.
How what is the balance.
Mm.
I even already there I can try to move the sacrum like a little bit like osteopath might do it.
Yeah.
And then the other hand again check from the back where is the tension in the back here.
Yeah.
And a little bit like go around the tension and measure it.
Yeah.
And do some work. And that's the beginning.
Right.
And then we just do it every day. We start from the sacrum, check it, and little measuring the the tensions. And sometimes it's just like, okay, now it's much softer.
Yeah.
And it can happen very quickly because somehow the body recognizes when somebody does the right technique.
When someone's trying to help.
When somebody try to help in the right way.
Yeah.
Maybe somebody wants to help, but they doesn't know how to do it. But when intentions. Somebody wants to help and the body recognizes that this is the right way.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's a natural way. So the healing process starts when there is like, the body recognizes that now there is a right method.
Yeah.
And it feels like it's not forcing. It's not pushing hard, it's just like slowly starting the process. And
yeah.
And it's very interesting. So this is what I'm trying to learn more.
Right. And so how do you learn more? Is it purely by changing a technique and seeing whether that is more effective? Or are you guided by intuition and your own sense of the body and understanding, having been involved with the healing for so long?
Yeah, mostly it comes from the self-realization.
Right.
Like you just look and try, and if it works, you keep that technique.
Yeah.
If it doesn't, you change. But I also look around. I come to your massage, I go to Natalie, I go to different people, and I observe, and I like, okay, that was a nice technique, you know.
Yeah, I do the same. I'm not ashamed to say I'll collect anything that works, I'll have it.
Yeah. Also, like picking up from Patabi Choice, from Sherrod, from Lino Miele, from Eddie Stern, from all different teachers, Noah Williams, you know, Richard Freeman. And you look and you observe and, and like, this was really good. That was a good adjustment. Just take it quickly.
And you were talking off camera before we started, and you said that when you were in Mysore with Guruji, you actually saw him also do a bit of body work on somebody.
Yeah, there was my friend had a bicycle accident and fell quite badly. And one day we like saw that Guruji was giving massage for him in the old yoga shala. I was like, wow, I never seen that before.
Yeah, exactly.
So he was doing massage and some stretching for the body and like really like a therapy work for them. I don't know how common it was, but that was first time I saw it.
Yeah. And do you think that is, I mean, obviously, you know, it's not for everybody, but for as a role of a teacher, it is a little bit broader, isn't it, than just instructing asana?
Well, it depends the teachers. Some teachers are very much in the asana and showing the pose, and everything is very physical. And some teachers learn more. They all can be good teachers, you know.
Yeah, yeah. And with yourself, you came out of that Finnish folk healing, didn't you? And so when you first started to teach, did you immediately not even think about the fact that when you were adjusting somebody, you were going to do something?
No, I think I didn't use so much the healing techniques in the beginning.
Right.
It was mostly just Patabi Choice and Lino Mieles and Derek Ireland's techniques.
Right. So you were doing what you were told.
Yeah, like super hard adjustments.
Yeah. And so then what instigated the change? What sort of happened in your own mind that led to the way you are now?
I think almost everyone started to change in the end of the 90s.
Right.
And also Patabi Choice had a huge shift from the like super tough adjustments to much lighter and softer. And I think that it started to happen that time, like 99, 2000, 2001. Slowly getting more gentle and start to listen more.
Yeah.
I'm sure I used some techniques before, but they were more like a tough, strong techniques.
So what do you do for yourself when you're practicing? Because people often ask me that too. Okay, who do you go to when something's not right? Or so what do you do for your own body when you're sensing something?
I try not to go anywhere.
Yeah.
I try to find a solution.
In yourself?
Through the yoga.
Through the practice. Yeah. So what does that involve?
It's maybe a slow process, but it's very beneficial also for your own teaching.
Because
like breathing more times
in the asana
and try to find a comfortable pose and relax the body and not pushing so hard. That's one way to heal.
Yeah. And your particular body, is it the type that you're very, obviously you've worked on the sensitivity and that, because I'm getting that from you, but we have some students that they really don't know they've done anything wrong until the next day, or the day after, and then they think, oh Christ, what did I do in the practice?
Yeah, this is a problem. I be giving some adjustments and people feel amazing.
Yeah.
But then next day they come and say, like, my back hurts.
Yeah.
So I've been dropping off those adjustments.
Yeah.
Because this is has been in Marichasana Sea.
Right.
Especially because even if the adjustment is gentle.
Yes.
But because it is gentle, the person feels so comfortable that they feel like, oh, this is so good. I get deeper. And you're not really like pushing the person anywhere.
But they're going themselves now.
It just feels so comfortable and you're just opening the body and supporting. And the person goes so far that something happens in the lower back or something.
Yeah.
The next day they're like, So I had to change some of those adjustments. Even it wasn't hard adjustment, but
yeah,
but it supported the person too much to push by themselves.
Yeah.
And now in Marichastana Sea, what I only do is like put the hands together and hold it and keep the balance.
Yeah.
That they are not leaning too much
rather
back.
Rather than
giving that rotation.
Yeah. And are there other particular postures that hop out in your mind, maybe like Supta Kurmasana or stuff like that?
The Supta Kurmasana is quite safe if you just understand the anatomy.
Yeah.
That you have to rotate the legs, you have to rotate the arms.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's quite safe actually. Almost never happen anything.
Anything like that. Yeah. And so there's one thing to be being adjusted and something happens, but quite often people also do something in the practice while not being adjusted, but just by pushing too strong or not being sensitive enough. So how can people build on that sensitivity and awareness in the practice that they are going to the right place for them at that particular day or that particular moment?
Well, I don't think people push so much in my
no,
class.
No, but there might be
because
people watching this.
Because the whole energy in the class is
soft.
Is soft because I'm not focusing for the advanced people.
No.
I'm not like, now you did, and now you get the next pose, and now you get. So people get the idea that you have to be advanced and do the next pose, that you get attention from the teacher. Yeah. I'm not doing this. So people do advanced poses, but.
Yeah.
They are just like same as the beginners in the class.
Yeah.
I'm not giving any extra
they're being sensitive.
Attention from anybody. Yeah.
But if
so
people
get
watching,
the feeling that, okay, you know, I'm accepted in this class. I can be myself. And so there's very little of this, like injuries. And
in the shala.
In the shala. Mm. But of course, there is sometimes, but I think there is, I don't see it so much.
Not so much. But if people are watching at home and recognize these traits in themselves, they might practice with a particular teacher, but that's not important, or they might have a self-practice at home, but they're noticing that they are maybe being a little bit tough on themselves, how can they work on that sensitivity? What would you say is the first steps?
Well, maybe the first would be to work with the breath.
Okay.
Just to soften the breath.
Yeah.
Because maybe there is too much sound, maybe they're forcing too much the breath.
Yeah.
Like Sarat nowadays, he talks more about this, like breathing very softly, like almost without sound.
Okay.
It became a... So if you breathe like that, you can't push so hard.
Yeah.
It comes through the breath. The other thing is just soften, like it's not easy if you come from a
competitive background. Yeah,
like
exactly.
Like the gym, the same thing. Some like dance, ballet, or something.
Yeah,
it might be hard. But
yeah.
But I think many people learn it if the teacher doesn't pay too much attention for the just like this advanced and advanced and advanced, and you have to go deeper and you have to reach this and that. Just follow like this comfortable state.
Yeah.
I think it comes from there. You know, people just realize this is so much better.
Yeah.
And maybe they don't read so quickly the advanced practice, but
but
they also
they
can practice without injuries and they feel very comfortable.
And sometimes sometimes in Ashtanga, it can be very, very strict. You know, you can't do this before you do that, da, 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 da. But with your own teachings, are there times when you feel, okay, this particular posture would actually help this student because I can see they need some opening here or there or whatever?
So I'm also strict if the person is like 25 and has a normal body, no injuries. I'm also strict. I'm like, this is the way.
Yes. Yeah. Because.
But if the person is 65, or injured, or has a certain like something in the body that, you know, like one leg is like 3 centimeters shorter or something.
Yeah.
And then of course the hip is like this. you have to think a little bit. You can't just let the person to do primary race forever.
Yeah.
Otherwise, they will start some other yoga style.
Yeah.
Where people are more tolerant.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's a big problem, but if you want to keep people in Ashtanga and really like find the yoga from Ashtanga, you have to see the person how they are and what kind of background, what is the problem. And there is plenty of poses where you can use for the therapy from the second series.
Yeah. So what, like some of the easier back bends and that type of thing?
Those are the main. Those are the maybe the best ones if somebody has any kind of back problem.
Yeah.
But nowadays I recommend them to relax more and
breathe longer. And with your own practice, I mean, it's quite difficult for traveling teachers because you've got the teaching, you've got the travel days, you've got different time zones and everything like that. So it's quite hard on your body and also on your getting into a flow. So do you notice a big difference between when you're at home? Do you actually have blocks of time when you're at home that are a couple of months?
Yeah, it's great to be in one place for more than 2 weeks.
Or yeah, that's
more than 1 week. So you get the back to the flow and you start to feel like, okay, now I make some progress. And you just have to adjust it then.
And do you feel that sometimes do you have ups and downs daily? If we took a space of a week, when you arrive on the mat, do you feel some days, oh, my body feels so stiff and so I'm going to, or do you arrive on the mat with a purpose of what you're going to do that day? Or does it all sort of evolve from your first experiences of the A's and B's?
Well, I focus for the meditation.
Right.
And I just do how the body feels. Like, of course, I try to do like how is the system, but sometimes it just doesn't feel right. Or I do much softer. But the meditation is the main thing.
The main thing.
So when you start the practice, you don't think like how flexible I am, how stiff I am. You just think like, calm down the mind, breathe deeply, find the kind of the comfortable pose. And sometimes the pose goes deeper, sometimes it doesn't, and that's the difference. But the mind state is almost the same, you know, if the body is more stiff or flexible, or if you're tired or not tired, the mind state is almost the same.
And are you thinking of, because I'm thinking, oh Christ, my body is stiff today.
That's the same. That's the same experience. The same. You feel like, okay, today the body is not wanting to do the asana so much. But you can still do it. But just.
And as far as that meditative state goes, are you thinking of anything in particular or trying not to think about something, or how is it manifesting in yourself? So obviously you're thinking of the breath, or not?
Yeah, the breath. But there is a certain like state of mind which is which comes through the breath, which comes from the experience. It's like a meditative state of the mind. And then I try to follow that state, you know. It's almost like you have like this beautiful sensation of like peace and calmness and maybe some light.
Yeah.
And then you just keep it there and follow that sensation and just follow it all the time.
Nice.
And there was Patabi Choice once say that we should follow that that kind of state of energy which leads in the end to the spirituality and some kind of deeper realization.
Yeah.
And I think I tried to do something like that.
Along those lines, yeah.
I don't know how deep I am in this, but but it just feels very, very good to follow that state instead of thinking so much about the body.
Yeah, and striving to do this.
Because then I can do yoga with the stiff body, with the flexible body, with all different kind of sensations in the body, and I can. It still feels very, very good.
Yeah. And I know some of the afternoon sessions you do here are based around sort of healing, that sort of thing. So what does that involve? And can you sort of give us a taster of stuff that people could try at home, that simple techniques?
Yes, sure. So a little bit about this. Sometimes we are much more sensitive what we think, and people are all connected in the, maybe it's hard to say like with the words what is the level, but in some level of mind or energy or information, there is a connection between everyone. And Patanjali talks a little bit about this in the third chapter in Yoga Sutras. How to focus the mind and how to sense different things. When you focus the mind to the object and when you keep it there, and the communication, how it starts to happen between this like seer and the object.
Yeah.
And what kind of information they start to move and how it happens. But people, they maybe read third chapter, but they don't think that I can do this.
Right.
It's like, okay, this feels like this is some magician work.
Totally alien
and this,
to them.
Yeah, and like how this is possible, like make something lighter or heavier or something. But it's not so difficult. Of course, to do it like in some very, very advanced level, it might be hard work, but in a very primary level, anybody can do it. So I'm teaching people to sense and have the connection with the object and sense get the information from that object.
Yeah.
And we use the other person in this, but it could be the tree, it could be plant, it could be dog, it could be anything.
If they'll sit still long enough.
Yeah, it's an object and your focus, the mind focus, and just keep your mind there, and definitely the information starts to flow.
Right.
So I've been teaching people to listen and understand the information and observe it. And it's very, very simple. It's so simple that people sometimes ask, like, can it really be this simple?
Yeah.
Like, I'm sensing. I'm not coming from the healer family. I don't have any skills.
No.
I'm a normal person from this town.
Yeah.
And, you know, I thought I'm not a very sensitive person. And when we do these techniques, they can sense something, and they're very surprised.
Yeah.
That me, who's not nothing,
yeah,
I can sense like amazing things.
Yeah.
And so everyone can sense things where they never believed.
And so,
and it's not about like angels and spirits and gods. It's a very kind of clear connection.
So more on an energy level?
Yeah, the energy level, yes, maybe it's energy level. It's some kind of information which flows to your system, and it goes to your mind and the brain, and you get the information. You know, because you cannot see the information.
No, exactly.
So it's really hard to explain, because the information just flows like electricity, maybe. You cannot see the, you know, you can call somebody, but you don't see how
it happens.
Where the voice moves.
Yeah. And what
it just comes to your brain. You know?
What sort of form does this information take? You know, that you're receiving some information.
Yeah, it comes to your body. It comes to your body level.
Yeah.
So you feel it in your body. It comes like a thought. It comes like a thought, like how you're thinking. You know, it comes like this. Some people might experience colors, and some people might see pictures, like a medium type of information. Yeah, different people experience different ways. But usually, what we do in the class is that we try to get information from the other person's tensions or pains or or this kind of blocks, which is blocking the nerve system, maybe the blood circulation, maybe some fluid. What is there? The
lymphatic fluid.
Yeah, maybe lymphatic fluid or something, which is blocking those. So it blocks the energy movement.
Yeah,
because the energy, also the blood is energy movement. One kind of nadi.
Yeah.
It's also the physical nadi. So we try to make connection and get the information and sense it in our system.
So is this something we can have a go at then? And something that you maybe could lead me through and allow people to try and follow along at the same time?
Yeah, I can show simple,
maybe
one of the most simple way how you can start.
Yeah.
And then I can also show the next state.
Nice. I'll leave it in your hands. I'll be your willing student.
So what happens when you sense the other person and the tensions, maybe pains, maybe even emotional problems? In the end, when you finish the observation or reading, maybe we call it reading, you have to get rid of that information,
right?
Because you cannot leave it to your system.
Yeah,
you don't want to leave other person's problems to your body.
No, thanks.
Or your
much.
Mind.
Yeah.
So in the end, you have to let it go.
Yeah.
If you don't let it go, you might have next day the same pain. And this is why the person who does this technique has to be balanced.
Right.
Not having too many issues.
That's the person receiving the information.
Yeah, the right. Healer part.
Yeah.
The person.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if somebody has mental, what is the
instability?
Yeah, instability or some kind of like, yeah, maybe that's the.
That's a polite way of putting it, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, it's not good even maybe to try.
Yeah.
Because you might get too excited.
And, yeah. So if you're highly stressed or suffering from trauma or that sort of stuff, okay.
It's better just to let it be like that and not trying.
Yeah. And can because you use the same technique on yourself?
Yeah, you can use it on yourself.
Right.
So from this, what Patanjali talks in Yoga Sutras, like making something lighter or heavier, those are also very practical techniques you can use even if you carry something heavy. You can just with your mind have a thought like now this is lighter, and it really becomes lighter. It's not so difficult. I do all the time when I give adjustment, especially the backbend adjustment. There is some people very heavy.
Yeah.
So I'm not using like all my strength. I imagine the person lighter, and I can even imagine the person softer and more flexible. And this way, when I do adjustment, even the person after the adjustment, they are like, wow, this was like amazingly easy.
Yeah.
And I haven't say anything for the person.
Can you bottle that? And we could sell it here at Purple Valley.
No, everybody can do it, and it's very, very simple. You just think and make the, have like a, I would say, strong strong thought.
And focus.
And focus.
So, yeah,
and you just keep it like softer, lighter, and kind of like more flexible even.
Yeah, so if you were in your own back bend or something, you could
You can do the same thing. You know, I think many athletics nowadays do those techniques.
Maybe they call it visualization.
Yeah, they call it visualization, but it's the same technique.
Mm, yeah.
So just visualize the person to be something else. It's very, very simple.
Just don't turn me into a toad or something as we're in the jungle here. It's like I've got to go home at the end.
Yeah, of course the very advanced healers, they can do techniques what we cannot do.
Yeah.
Because they've been really practicing hard and maybe they are especially sensitive person,
yeah.
People. But what we do now, anybody can do.
Okay. So how do you need me?
Just make sure that don't do it if you are feeling
stressed
or not very stable.
Mm. I think I'm stable. I'm calm.
You can
tranquil.
You can be anything. It's me. Yeah, I have to be.
Oh yes. Okay. So do I have to be any particular way or?
Yeah. So I can explain first.
Yeah. I'll shut up.
So so one is lying down on the stomach. And take a comfortable pose. And the person who is lying down doesn't have to think anything special. Just even sleep or, you know, just be normal. But don't try to help. Don't try to send me any information or anything. Just be and lie down. And I put my hands on your back and from the lower back, I slowly start to go through your physical body. And once I sense some tension, okay, here is very clearly the muscle, some tightness, maybe some pain. I put my finger there and I keep my finger. And then I try to observe my own back and have this sensation in my own back. So actually your tension in my back.
Can you keep it when you find it?
Yeah. So this is the easy way to start. So you move from the physical body, and when you find the tension, you kind of connect yourself to that person and start to observe your body, and you start to feel the same sensation in exactly in the same spot in your own body.
Okay.
And that's how it's maybe easiest way to start the energy work. So actually the connection information work.
Yeah.
So I don't know exactly what is moving from your body to my body. Is it energy? Is it information? Whatever it is, but
something.
But the main thing is that I sense it.
Yeah.
And. So that's the primary level.
Yeah.
And we move forward, we go to the next tension, keep the finger there and try to sense it in your own body. And then we move to the next one and try to sense it. So this way you start to create this connection information and understanding that how it works.
Yeah.
And you start to trust yourself that, okay, this sensation is the same as what is under my finger.
Right.
And then we go to the next place, you're like, okay, I feel it. So it's not just the accident that you feel something, but yeah. You feel every time, so
yeah.
It must be real.
Yeah. And it's not that you're trying to press deeply into the muscle to feel that tension, but you're sensing the tension?
Yeah, no, you just have to feel the tension. Yeah. Okay. Nothing else. And. The second stage, from sensing first from the physical body, then try to have the connection in your own body. The next stage is sensing the tensions, the pains without touching the body.
Right.
So only through having this connection and the information which is moving.
Yeah.
So just standing like this or sitting, and focusing for your system.
Yeah.
And observing my own body, and then you start to slowly feel the tensions, what do you have in your body. So that's the second stage, which is already much, much deeper.
Yes.
So without looking the body, without feeling it, you just start to sense something.
Yeah.
And when it comes to the healing point, the easiest way to heal is when you sense the tension, you completely try to relax it from that area. So that's like the easiest healing technique. Like relaxing, melting, softening. And then you sense it in your own back that it really happens, that this tension starts to soften. And it's not my body which is softening. I just feel your body in my body.
Yes, yeah.
But I work through my body, which is now not so much my body anymore. It's the sensation come from your.
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool.
So that's a.
That's the breathe.
That's the chop.
Okay.
So first touching, try to sense, move, try to sense, move, try to sense. The second technique, without touching, try to sense. And then when you feel the tension or pain, try to soften it. But this is very, like, I don't know. I think it's quite easy.
Yeah.
To start. There's so many, many techniques, but
this is the simple ones. And yeah. Can it then be built upon that? I know there's sort of visualization techniques where, say, you've got a painful hip, that you can then start thinking about that area on your body and the same sort of idea of softening and that type of thing. So that where along the line
but
would
now
that particular step be? That be a little bit later or?
Yeah, visualization is not so much part of this technique.
Right.
Because it all really happens in the.
Right.
It all really happens. You don't have to kind of believe or visualize anything.
Right.
It really happens.
Okay.
And when you're softening it, like softening your own body.
Yeah.
If you have tension, you try to work with your mind and, okay, calm down, relax. So this is the way.
Yeah.
The visualization, yeah, you could maybe use a little bit of this, the same as in a backbend.
Yeah.
But it's really happening in a physical level.
Yeah, or even sending energy, they talk about sometimes, to that particular area. So you're not necessarily visualizing, but a little bit like
sending the energy works when there is emptiness in the body.
Right.
So there can be, they can be stress in the body. They can be like this kind of like tension where the energy gets stuck.
Yeah.
And it's not moving. It's like India, they call tamas. It's something dark and it's not moving. They can be also like a spot in the body where it's pain, but there is a lack of energy.
Right.
So there is like empty spot.
Yeah.
And for that, if there is emptiness, you can send energy from the
outside.
Outside or even from the body.
Yeah.
So if there is a knee pain on the right knee and you feel like there's no energy. So you can move the energy from the left knee to the right knee and then try to balance it.
Balance things out.
And this like and this all really happens. It's not it's nothing to believe. It just really happens when you use the mind and move the energy from here to here.
Yeah.
It really moves.
And do you sense areas of not by physical touch, but the perception of hot and cold areas or that sort of thing?
Yeah, this some people feel more hot and cold.
Yeah, or color-wise, or
yeah, it can also.
Yeah.
I'm not sensing so much colors. But yeah. It's more light or darkness.
Right, light or dark. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Some people see all different colors.
Cool. So how do you need me then? Are you going to experiment on me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you want to come
I
here?
I can come over here.
Okay. Here we are. Stu is there in a nice position and we start from the lower back with my hands here and I start to do this little massage and I try to sense where is the tension in the body. From the physical body, so it's not so difficult. And when you do both sides at the same time, it's quite easy to feel like, okay, one side is softer and one side is harder. Like here, left side is softer, right side is harder. So already here, there's a little bit tension, so I can leave my finger here and start to observe my own body. And get the information to my own system. You might get much more information what is just under the finger. Okay. So now, after this, we move forward. I have to go here because I get this sensation that it's that is on the right side. The whole side here has some. So we continue moving slowly up. Stu has a nice, quite soft body. Soft body type. Not too much tension, actually. So every time you have any sensation of the stiffness, tension, pain or something, stay there and try to get the connection and sense it in your own back. Like this. And after, you can move forward. This is quite good. It's not too much. Good. So this way, we go through the back, try to find the tension from the physical body, stay there, and observe your own back, try to get the sensation to your own back. Okay. Good. So this was the first one, first technique. The second one, we do it without touching the physical body. Now actually it would be better to change the person, so because now we already did from the physical body. So the next work, we do the same. Now I could stand up, but I can also be here. I go a little bit further. So I'm knowing that I'm doing it for Stu, so I don't have to think like doing it for this. I know that I do it for him. So the connection is there, and I start to observe my own back. And relax your body, keep the mind calm. Don't expect anything. Keep the mind open. And slowly start to observe your own back and the sensations, especially if there is anything which is like a pain, stiffness, tension. And the sensation is a little bit like a numbness or lack of blood circulation or something hard in the muscle. Okay, so now I kind of, what we can call reading, I was observing my own back and try to sense if there is tension or pain. And now it's a different level, because in the beginning I went there with the physical, with my fingers. Now there is no fingers, so the sensation is kind of deeper sensation. And when I touched the physical body, I could feel that there was the right side. But now, when I went there in the other kind of level, I felt that there's tension on the shoulder blades and shoulders on the both sides, maybe from the work what Stu is doing. So all this area here is tense, but maybe there is no pain, it just feels tension, some stiffness here. So it's quite soft sensation when there is only tension. When there is a pain, it's much stronger sensation. Okay, so this area. And now the third one. Now I work with this area. So the third one. Now we do the healing, which was the first. The easiest way to do the healing is the relaxation, softening or melting the tension or pain. Now I'm observing my own back and this area on the upper back, and completely relaxing, softening, melting. And I do it in my own body. And when you sense that something is happening, that it starts to soften, the tension starts to kind of disappear, or the pain, and you can slowly start to stop. There's still tension, but this is the first treatment, so it's okay to just a little bit start the process of the softening. And next time when we do it, we continue and get it deeper. Now there's a nice warm sensation on the upper back. Almost like somebody put some cream, warming cream on the back. That's how I sense. Good. It's over.
And I felt heat myself in those areas that you were sensing stuff going on. So that low back on the right, you know, would be an area that, of tightness for me, because I have a scoliosis, so it's sort of an adaptation, tensional pattern. And of course in the neck because of every sort of the hard stuff I do. But I did feel heat coming to those areas, particularly once your hands were off of me. So I felt a lot of heat coming from your hands when they were on me,
yeah,
which was nice. And but also when you were just thinking about what was going to be happening with me, I could feel those areas heating up.
Yeah.
So it was, yeah.
Yeah, sometimes people start to sweat,
yeah,
when you do the reading part.
Yeah. So it's quite cool. So go play and practice and see whether you can sense those sort of things on yourself. And thanks so much, Petri. I feel like on my maybe I'll do all my interviews like this in future, I think, laying on my chaise lounge and interviewing people. That would be quite nice. But yeah, thanks so much, Petri,
yeah,
for
thank
coming
you.
Down and doing this with us. It's been brilliant.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
After the healing session, we come back to our own body. And ground ourselves. Let the connection go and also the sensation go. If there was a knee pain, let it go. Soften, lighten. So you can take a comfortable pose. Sit down. And first, start to think about your own physical body. The muscles, the sitting position, the connection to the crown. And cut the connection with the person you did the healing. Cut the connection mentally, physically, and come back to yourself, only thinking about yourself, the physical body, the connection to the earth, your own thoughts, your own energy flow. Let the tensions go, let the pain go. And when you feel that you are back to yourself, feeling strong and it's done. Thank you.